Hello everyone, Ryan here with Product Impressions. We are outside today because I just recently bought a 2024 Honda Civic Sport model with a manual transmission and naturally aspirated engine. I've had this car for about a month and I am really happy with it, so I figured I would actually go ahead and post up a video. Unfortunately, this is the second take of walking around the exterior because when the camera was mounted on my head, I wasn't actually able to see what was in frame and I missed basically the entire top of the car. I've upgraded from a 2004 Pontiac Sunfire, so that one also was a manual transmission, and this seemed to be basically the closest that I could get while still having a manual transmission and a naturally aspirated engine. I do appreciate that they have the naturally aspirated engines because most everything else that you'll find is going to be turbocharged, which does get more horsepower out of the engine, but also seems to, you know, die faster. Added heat, added spinny parts makes things wear out quickly. In my experience, turbocharged engines good for perhaps 6 years, and then you start having problems. And if you can tell from upgrading from a 2004, I keep cars for a long time, so I want something that's going to be more reliable. All in all, I am very happy with this car. I haven't really done any modifications to it, other than some tints in the windows, because as you can see, this is unfortunately an outdoor car at the moment. So I put some tints in to protect the interior, but otherwise, it is a very nice looking car, very sporty, even though it is a lower end trim. I really do like the wheels. They did a good job with the styling on here. It looks very nice. This is the absolute bottom end model, so still with the chrome lug nuts, which I actually think look nice. You can spend some extra money and get black ones, but I don't think that that is really necessary. Walking around the exterior here, in order to lock and unlock, you can just touch here to lock or grab the handle to unlock. That does get a little bit fiddly when you are washing the car. That is something to keep in mind. Just the spray of the water is going to lock and unlock it. So it may actually be nice to not have constant clicking and beeping while you're washing the cars if you just don't have the keys in your pocket while you're doing that. You can change what doors lock or unlock when you touch that. I have it set to unlock everything so that I don't have to open the door and then hit one of the locks inside. If I want to put something in the back, I can just touch the door handle and then go into the back. But otherwise, yeah, the next thing that we will see here is the gas cap. This does open very easily. It is a capless, but there is a downside of it opening very easily, which is when you are washing the car, every time the sponge passes over, it's going to pop open or pop open, what have you. It just is going to click back and forth all the time every time a sponge passes over. So that is a little annoying. Thankfully, when the car is locked as it is currently, it is not actually going to. It stays closed when the car is locked. So nothing to be worried about. If you leave your car, no one can actually get into it, even though it is a capless. There is a good amount of room in the back seat. I have had 4 people. There is room for 5 in here. The only thing that gets a little bit fiddly with that is if someone is particularly large, there are seatbelt sensors and it may start chiming at you if somebody is spreading out a little bit, shall we say, and the seatbelt is not buckled. So that can get a little bit finicky, along with a couple other areas that we will discuss. But yeah, all in all, it is very nice. We've got a very sporty looking back end. The only change I might make back here, it's actually possibly to remove the Civic and Sport emblems. I do the Honda emblem on the back, that's perfectly fine, but the Civic and the Sport ones, I don't know, it looks a little bit busy to me, so maybe those will come off at some point, but for the time being, I'm just very pleased with all of this. And I'll try and put up some comparison images so that you can see the difference between the 50% tints that I have on here right now, which look particularly dark in this lighting, and what it was when it was brand new. going to the interior. The only thing that I have changed inside at this point is this down here. There is typically just kind of an open space here where you can put your phone for Android Auto and all of that when it's plugged in. I decided to put in this little tray here that separates it out into three different areas, primarily because this way, when I have my phone in here, it can go into an upper tray there, and that will stop it from having all of the weight rest on the power plug. This is obviously going to depend on the size of phone that you have, but when I initially had it in here without that tray, when the phone is down on the bottom and it is plugged in, all of the weight from the phone was resting on the power plug right here. So in order to actually preserve my phone, I got this nice little like $12 tray to put inside. The armrest here is a little bit oddly shaped in order to accommodate the manual transmission and two cup holder. So you've got this big cutout here. I have seen some people complain about when they are resting their arm here. I did not notice any problem there as far as comfort when I'm driving. So no real issues there. The inside here, it's a little bit small, but it's not too bad. It'll fit, you know, some sunglasses cases and pretty much whatever you need to carry as long as it's not too large. Another oddly finicky thing about this is the design of the wiper blades. So you can see that they are down here and the pivot point is actually underneath the hood. So if you want to lift up these in order to clean the windshield, or if you need to adjust anything, you actually need to manually just pull them up before you can actually position it up and change out the wiper blade or whatever the case may be. Otherwise, it's actually going to hit on the back end of the hood here. So that is something to be aware of. Some people have complained about that online. I don't see that as being a terribly big issue. You can still get everything nice and clean without too much of a problem. The wiper blade on the back, on the other hand, is a little bit more difficult to clean around because it only lifts by a couple of inches. That is as high as you can lift it, so it does get a little bit weird to try and clean underneath the back wiper. Otherwise, no real problems there. Let's go ahead and get in and start things up. Some areas where I do think some corners have been cut, well, not necessarily corners cut, but just something that they do to save some money, is the seat fabric. I don't know, compared to my 2004, feels a little bit cheap, but all in all is not bad at all. Did hear the chime and see the little Honda logo show up on the dashboard when you first get in. I always start by putting on the seatbelt because, you know, that's a good idea. There we can see how it looks when it's turning on. Hopefully you can actually see everything on the dashboard, because I cannot adjust the steering wheel any higher.
An hour or 2 hours a day.
Just turn off the audio there. When you do get in, it seems a little bit fiddly to me because you can see down here we've got all of these buttons here, and with how I like to drive, of course, first off you need to turn off that, turn off the, disengage the parking brake. This is the auto engine stop for if you're sitting at a light or anything. I really don't think that it is worth putting the hundreds of additional starting rotations on the starter motor, so turn that off. Now you can see it says it's off there. You can press the home key to dismiss. Press the home key. So basically every time you get in the car, you have to hold down the brake and the clutch and press the ignition down here behind the steering wheel, and then disengage that, turn off that system, press the home button. I mean, it's little things, but they do seem to add up. It does add to a bit of frustration. You can change what is displayed in the middle of the tachometer. I do like to have the range displayed there so that I can see how far I'm going to be going, but you can set this to different things. Any warnings that show up have nothing in there whatsoever. Customize it, different settings, maintenance, seatbelts. Yeah, maintenance will just, whoops, a safety support system. It's telling me if I'm going to get too close. Maintenance. You can see how much oil life is left. I've been driving for a bit over a month. I've got almost 3,400 miles on there and still 70% of oil life, so that's nice. Whether the seat belts are on, driver attention system, speed and time. I don't see why you would want to have the speed on there because you've got your speedometer in multiple different ways. You've got a digital one in the middle and an analog off on the right-hand side, so that would be kind of redundant. So I stick with range and fuel. Down here we've also got a brake hold feature, which is nice if you're new to driving manuals, or even if you have been driving them for quite a while. It is nice to have a brake hold feature because that means that you can pull up to a light, as I do almost immediately after leaving home, and you don't have to worry about rolling backwards. Sorry for the panning back and forth, but do need to make sure that I'm being safe. Not sure how much engine noise is going to come through, but it's definitely quieter than my 2004 Sunfire. But it's still just loud enough that you can actually hear the engine. You know when to shift, which is nice. Typically, I tend to be a very conservative driver, so I end up shifting when the tachometer is between 2 and 3,000 RPM. I have never redlined a car. I don't really see a need to. I prefer to drive in a very fuel-efficient manner. And as you can see, my average fuel economy rated there is 34.8 miles per gallon currently, and I've been driving for about half a tank at this point. That seems to be pretty standard for me. It is rated to get up to 37 on the highway, and I will say that that is an actual number that you can achieve, though that average fuel economy rating is wrong. It is always high by 2 miles per gallon. Every time I have filled up, I have done the calculations, and it is always telling me that I'm getting 2 miles per gallon better than I actually am. We're going to go ahead and get on here so that we can get up to more of a highway speed. You can hopefully see that there is a green bar showing up over the 51 miles per hour. That is just showing you if you are driving in an economically friendly manner. Or ecologically friendly. Works both ways. There is an eco drive mode that you can turn on, which basically forces the car to stay in that green zone. I chose to get a manual transmission because there aren't a lot of automatic transmissions available anymore. Everything is going to continuously variable, which in my experience feels incredibly sluggish, uninspiring, just not fun to drive. So we are going to the manual. Everything is very smooth with this. The shifting is way smoother than it was when I was driving a Sunfire. Things have come a long way in the last 20 years. Just kind of coasting on down here. It is also very nice that we've got actual physical controls. Not everything goes through the touchscreen. So for the climate system, you can turn it on and off and auto, or actually this one is on and off. That's to switch it to auto, adjust the temperature by twisting the knob, adjust the fan by twisting the knob, change the mode by twisting the knob. And we've got recirculation, defrost the front, defrost the rear, turn on the AC generally. So all in all, everything is very straightforward, very nice. I think we got up to a decent enough speed, no need to get onto the freeway at this point. Or people are not gonna let me get off. So hey, we're getting on the freeway, fantastic. Check out the cruise control features. On the right hand side of the steering wheel here, you've got the cruise control on and off. Cancel out the current setting. Setting it with the distance. So it can automatically adjust your speed to maintain a certain distance between you and the car in front of you. And lane keep assist. I do enjoy the lane keep assist. When I turn that on, you can see we've got green lights, green lines on the center of the dash there. If you do start to veer off to the one side or the other, it will start to tell you like, hey, there we go, lane departure, and it's warning you, it turns it orange. Otherwise, you can pretty much take your hands off the wheel and it will keep you centered in the lane. If you do this for too long though, warning gonna pop up momentarily. Hey, steering is required, yes. I have gone on some very long road trips and even having your hands on the wheel, that will still show up every once in a while. So it's a little incongruous in that it will seem to want you to both have your hands on the steering wheel, it will be keeping you centered, but it also wants you to fight it keeping you centered, otherwise it's going to tell you that steering is required. So there are some very fiddly aspects of this whole driver assist thing that they turn on, so I can go into all of that in another video, which I think I will do next. But you can see here, going around the corner, keeping me centered. You actually hit the turn signal, those lines go white. It's not keeping me centered anymore, but it's also not fighting me as I turn. There is a lane departure warning that is automatically turned on when you get the car. And that is something that I am profoundly unaccustomed to. And every time that I veer off, like you can see, there's an exit there that has a dotted line. If I don't want it fighting me and shaking the steering wheel every time that I go to get off an exit, that is a system that I find very useful in turning off. The lane keep assist comes on when you hit 45 miles an hour and turns off again when you drop down to 40. Worth noting if you are in some slower traffic. The one thing that I haven't tested and really don't want to be in a situation where I'm testing is if the cruise control is on, it will slow you down based on the speed of the traffic in front of you, but it's also not going to shift for you when you have the manual transmission. So if you're gonna drop down to about 45 miles an hour, you're gonna need to actually be paying attention and shifting. That becomes problematic because one thing that has happened is I have gone to shift because I noticed, oh, I'm not in the appropriate gear for the speed that I'm going. And if the cruise control is on and you depress the clutch, the cruise control system is going to rev the engine to try and get you up to that speed. Since it's impossible to do that while the engine is not in gear, it is just going to run it up to the red line. So you do not want to press in on the clutch while you've got the cruise control engaged. Disengage cruise control before you do anything like that. It is nice and responsive. I do enjoy driving the manual transmission, even though I live in the DC area and traffic can be a bit of a nightmare at times, I still find it's worth it to have the manual transmission. Otherwise, the interior is very nice here. I do like the styling with the grille running all the way down the side. It does kind of hide the vents, so that is one thing to keep in mind if you're constantly putting your cell phone into a holder that is attached to an air vent. You basically can't use those in this car. Driven over this way in a while. Fair amount of new construction. Things are always changing around here. This does have Android Auto, but only a wired connection, so that's why I've got the wire down here. I'm not connecting it at the moment, just so I don't run into any copyright issues with the music playing or anything like that. But otherwise, even as soon as you do connect your phone through the wired connection, it will also make a Bluetooth connection. So there's no, I don't recall ever having to actually make a Bluetooth connection. but it still will work. If I press phone, I can go to the phone, radio for radio, media if I want to play whatever podcast or MP3s we're playing off of my phone, or the Kinect if you actually do hardwire and it doesn't automatically switch over, you can press that, because if I were to have it playing a podcast on the media setting, even if I hardwire it, it will just go back to playing through that. And I can then have to press connect in order to bring up Google Maps and all of the normal Android Auto functionality. That is something else that is a little bit strange with this, is there is an incredible difference in the volume settings between Bluetooth being connected and Android Auto being hardwired. The volume range in this system, it goes from 0 to 40 is what they have as their maximum number. When I have the phone hardwired in, a decent listening volume seems to be around 13, 14 on that 0 to 40 scale. When it's connected by Bluetooth, I need to have it cranked up to about 38 to 40 in order to have it be the equivalent volume. If you're just driving around normally, as I am now with all of the windows up and everything, that is not really a problem. But if you like to drive with the windows down, that kind of becomes a problem, because then the maximum volume is not loud enough for you to hear when you're driving at any kind of actual speed with the windows down. So that is something to keep in mind. If you like driving with the windows down, you're going to want to actually hardwire the phone in and not rely on that Bluetooth connection, because it just simply will not be loud enough. Some points that I am a little bit disappointed on, but this is the absolute lowest trim. There is only the one USB port here. That does do the Android Auto for the overall system, but it's kind of weird that there is only a single USB port in this car. I know it is the absolute bottom end trim, but still, that seems kind of ridiculous to me. So to that end, I do plan on hardwiring in some more USB ports, and one of those is going to be dedicated to some footwell lighting. That is something that I put into my 2004 Sunfire. I feel like it makes a big difference as far as the premium feel of the car, and I'm just kind of a sucker for ambient lighting effects that look classy. So that is going to be one of my projects that I'm going to engage in on here. I did get some tints put on the window because, as you could tell when I was walking around initially, this is an outdoor car. I don't have a garage at this point, and so in order to protect the interior from all of the UV light, I got some window tints put on. Those are 50% tints, which is the darkest that my home state allows for the driver and passenger windows. I did it all the way around. I am allowed to go darker for the back windows and hatchback, but I prefer to have a uniform look. I think that things kind of look a little strange when you've got different color windows on a car, so went with 50% all the way around, primarily to protect from the UV, but it does allow for some added privacy, if that is of concern to you. And it just kind of makes a car look cooler. Have some dark windows on there. I did mention having the seats feel a little bit cheap. I mean, they're fine. I've gotten used to them over the course of the more than a month that I've had this car, so I feel like they were nicer in my older car, but yeah, it's something that you get used to. They do seem to be a little bit wide, like my hips don't feel like they are held perfectly snugly. So that is of concern if you are going to be doing some kind of racing style driving. But at the same time, if you're doing racing style driving, you are probably not getting a bottom of the line trim level. The other point that I found, this is another way that I decided to kind of upgrade the car very quickly after I got it, is once I pull into my parking lot, I will show you, but the trunk storage area. It is nice. It is very large. You can fit a lot of stuff back there. I am constantly carrying around a speaker for hosting trivia events. And that is one way that I noticed that the carpet that they have in here is not the most durable. It's not really going to be much of an issue around the front, where it's really just, you know, shoes, boots, whatever the case may be. You can always get new cargo mats, but there is no mat that you get initially in the back of the car. And I noticed that even after just a few days, the carpet was really getting worn down underneath the speaker, because that would kind of rock back and forth, slide forward and back depending on acceleration and braking, things of that nature. So that is something to watch out for, and I do recommend getting a cargo mat to put into the back. I did that. The one that I got was, I believe, $50 on Amazon, as opposed to the 100 plus if you want to get the Honda branded one. I don't really see a need for that Honda branding on something as basic as a cargo mat. So we're gonna head on back. I do appreciate that I'm not hearing too much from the back, even though obviously being a hatchback, there is no barrier between me and the trunk space. There is just kind of a shield there to block people from actually seeing what is back there, but otherwise there's no hard materials as you would see in other vehicles. I always back in, so you're gonna get to see the rear view camera. You do have a few different settings for the video from the camera, so this is just kind of the default, which I have left on. Hey, I forgot to uncover the license plates before going for a drive. All right, let's go ahead. Parking brake is on. Let's turn this off. Let's go ahead and take a look in the back, since I didn't do that earlier. Coming right. I did mention the privacy screen, so that is this one here. And you can see there's a little light back there. With that back, you can see there's a good amount of space back here. I just recently measured it. It is about 34 inches front to back. Across the side, it is, I believe, 52 at this wider area back here. There is an indentation, seems wrong when it's going out, but there is an additional space 52 inches wide back here, and it is about 41 inches here at the wheel well. Here's the big speaker that I was talking about, and you can see the cargo mat area that I have. There's this whole plastic thing back here. Thankfully, there was no smell to it, and it also came with added pads for the seat backs as well to protect everything that way. So, yeah. That is the full trunk area. Let's go ahead and cover this up again, and you can see the second part of the privacy screen up here, which you can very easily just pop out in order to clean the back window. All right, I believe that is everything. So if you've got any questions or comments, feel free to leave them in the comment section down below. I'll do my best to answer whatever I can. Otherwise, yeah, like, share, subscribe. I will see you next time.